morning, everybody. I have my Dorothy shoes on today because it's Pentecost. I get to wear them three times a year, Pentecost, Reformation, and Christmas Eve. So, because of celebrating Memorial Day, we have no Bible study tomorrow or on Wednesday. Office is closed tomorrow. Today, we have the fellowship meal, and I made enough Italian beef for everybody. So go down and get some. And I know Anne made some, too. Hers is probably better. She's a great cook. So come on down, have some Italian beef and some goodies. It'll be fun down in the fellowship hall. And Jeff is all ready to go because he has his apron on.
It's red for Pentecost.
It's red for Pentecost.
And it acts as a bib, too, if I'm ready for lunch.
You're ready for lunch? You're ready to serve, and you're ready for Pentecost. A bib. So he's ready to eat. Yeah, eat, not serve. Today is also noisy offering, and this week's is going to the South Sudan ELCA ministry. To help, as you know, the chaos in the Sudan, and a lot of people are going to different areas around the Sudan to get away from all the turmoil. So we want to support the ELCA ministry in the South Sudan and also our South Sudanese ministry. And our foundation is also donating $160 toward that as well. Next week, t-shirts. Make sure you get your orders in today because next week I'm putting all of the orders in. So there are order forms in the back of the church. There are order forms in the narthex. And then you can pay Nancy Lewis on your way downstairs to the fellowship meal. Next week is the first Imagine 11 concert series. And that starts at 6 p.m. down at Coleman Hawkins. And it's a really great band. They have a great brass section, so I'm really excited. Yeah, Phil's smiling. There's a great brass section. So definitely go down for Imagine 11, and we will be there line dancing and having fun. So all are welcome. We also have Miss Addie with us today. Where's Addie? There she is. You can stand up and wave, friend. Hi, Addie. She is our new music person. But she's technically not working, so don't ask her questions. You can start your questions next week. This week, she's just here to worship with us and hopefully to eat food. Many months ago, we had Phil, formerly known as Phil in the Corner. Now it's Bruce in the Corner. But Phil in the Corner, you what? You're Phil in the blank now. He is good, fill in the blank. He joins the praise team as a percussionist and harmonica player and melodeon player and all the instrument player. Beginning in December, following Sharon's resignation, he supported the melody line of our hymns and other worship music when we didn't have a piano player. So now with Bruce in the corner and Addie joining us as the accompaniment, Phil has announced his intention to take a step back from the praise team so that he can sit with his lovely wife, Nancy, in the congregation. She'll be out in the narthex. But she's in the worship service to worship with Phil. So he promises, though, this, Addie, you can put in the back of your head. He does promise to do occasional musical offerings. Yay! So, Phil, we are so thankful for your musical gifts, and thank you so much for stepping in a time of absolute need and carrying us through until God blessed us with Addie. So thank you, fill in the blank. And Jim, who is our musical coordinator slash I was going to do a handoff of a baton next Sunday, so just get ready for that, because it's coming. So next Sunday, we're going to honor Jim as he hands the baton off to Addie. No pressure, Addie. All right, and are there any other announcements before Ann? What? Congregational meeting next week to vote on the parking lot, whether we're going to sell it or not. And you may have noticed the worship art. Oh, gosh, wonderful. The worship team brought the worship art. You might be able to see the face of Jesus through the holy flames of the Holy Spirit, which we're going to talk about more later. Because today we're celebrating the Holy Spirit igniting the hearts of the church. So we'll talk about that more later. And I invite Ann to come forward for an announcement.
I just want to invite all of you. As you all know, we've got some expenses as far as the parking lot being refinished to the south of us. There's some rain damage up in the ceiling of the chapel that also needs to be repaired. So we're going to do a fundraiser, and we invite all of you to come next Sunday at 4:25 to 5:25 before Imagine 11, and we'll have an old-fashioned ice cream social. So come and have your ice cream and your dessert before going to Imagine 11. Please bring your lawn chairs like you would be going to Imagine 11. And the big thing is we need everybody to write the check, because we have up to $500. We have a person that will match that $500. Now, the total cost of both these projects is about $6,000. So please come, enjoy the fellowship, have a great time outside, and we'll see you at not 4:30, 4:25. Thank you.
All right, let's calm our hearts and minds and prepare ourselves for worship with a moment of silence. When we were baptized with water. Whether we were baptized by the pastor sprinkling water on our heads or by being immersed in water, water is an essential part of baptism. We can't be baptized without water. It connects us to Jesus' baptism. It reminds us we are washed clean of sin. It drowns our old selves and gives us new life in Christ. The waters of baptism give life. In our sacrament of baptism, we use water. However, the Holy Spirit uses fire. If I can light it on fire. Oh, no, thank you. Okay. In our sacrament of baptism, we use water. However, the Holy Spirit uses fire. Today, we remember our baptism, not only of water, but of fire through the Holy Spirit. Please join me in our remembrance of baptism. Holy Spirit, baptize us with your holy fire. Burn away everything that is harmful, hurtful, and selfish. Ignite every part of our being to be on fire for you. Light the path you want us to walk. When we feel the fire going out, reignite it and give us the motivation to keep growing in our faith. Amen. We are invited to stand for our welcoming hymn.
Change.
of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Please join me in our prayer of the day. The day of Pentecost is here. The day when the flames of faith ignite our hearts. Holy God, don't let us sit comfortably when there is important work to do. Don't let us remain silent when there are important words to say. Put ants in our pants and rocks in our shoes so we can't ignore the fire of your Holy Spirit. Amen.
It's your turn, Jonathan.
Invited to be seated.
The reading is from Acts chapter 2. When the day of Pentecost had come, the apostles were all together in one place. I'll try it again. Okay. When the day of Pentecost had come, the apostles were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs. In our own languages, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power. All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them. "Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk as you suppose, for it's only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in heaven above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We are invited to stand for our gospel acclamation.
Alleluia, Lord, to whom shall we go?
Holy Gospel according to John chapter 20.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated, and I invite the children to come forward as we sing.
I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river in my soul. I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river in my soul.
Ooh, this is heavy. I think it's a ball. It's very round. Let's see what's in here. Oh, do you know what this is? It's a globe. That's Africa. And that's the United States right here. This is North America. And this is the United States right here. I need glasses, friends. Wow. This is small. We are about right there. And Jesus is all the way on the other side, right about here. Look at that. Almost on the entire other side of the globe. That's where Jesus was. Yeah. And what's really cool about the globe, we're going to talk today about how Jesus calls us to go out. So if Jesus is here, the disciples took the gospel of Jesus all the way over here to India, and all the way up here to Greece, and all the way down here into Africa and Egypt. So they took the gospel all over. And eventually, Jesus went all over the world. The gospel of Jesus went all over the entire world. And that's because people told other people about Jesus. So that's why it's so important for us to tell other people about Jesus, so that Jesus and everything that he taught us can go all over the world. So will you pray with me today? Jesus, it's not easy telling other people about you. So help us through the power of your Holy Spirit to know how to do that, so we can be like your disciples that went out into the world and told everybody about you, so that we can all know about you and love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, you can go back to your seats, and I'm going to give the children's bag to Jonathan, the tech guy, as we sing.
He flees like a river. I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river in my soul. I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river in my soul.
So Pentecost is one of my favorite church holidays. And I think Pentecost should be just as important as Christmas and Easter, because it's during Pentecost that the Holy Spirit comes down on the disciples and really starts the church. The Holy Spirit lights a fire in us to go and tell the world about Jesus and to really act out our faith. And it's during Pentecost that God gives us what's called the commission. A commission is a duty or a function that someone of authority gives to an individual or to a group. And if you think about it, you might have heard what's called the Great Commission. The Great Commission is in the end of the book of Matthew. It's Matthew chapter 28, and it's the most famous commission that God gave. So it says, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." So that's the most famous commission, because Matthew did a great job of making it very obvious and very concise. So God gives us the commission, the function, or the duty to go out and tell people about Jesus, and also to live by faith so that people can see how we live by faith. And if we read every gospel, there's actually this commission in each and every one. It's just not as obvious in Matthew, or in the other gospels, as it is in Matthew. So today we actually heard the Great Commission from the Gospel of Luke and the Gospel of John. The commission to tell people about Jesus and to live our faith each and every day. But you might be saying, "Wait, Pastor, I paid attention this Sunday, and we did not read from Luke. So how did we get the Great Commission from the Gospel of Luke?" Well, actually, the book of Acts is a continuation of the Gospel of Luke. So it should actually be Matthew, Mark, Luke, Acts, and John. But they separated Acts because Acts is actually the book that tells us about the history of the church. So it really has to start like at Christmas time when the Gospels, some of the Gospels start with the birth of Jesus. Acts starts with the birth of the church, which is Pentecost. So Luke's Great Commission actually comes in Acts 2. So we hear that on Pentecost, Jesus enters and gives the Holy Spirit to the disciples, and they have these tongues of fire that come down on their heads. And like I said, this happens during Pentecost, which we often think of as a Christian holy day, a Christian festival. But actually, it's Jewish. Pentecost is a Jewish festival. It's called Festival of the Weeks. And during this festival, all of the Jews most of the Jews would do a pilgrimage to the temple in Israel in order to give them what is called the first fruits. So what you would do is you would harvest the best of your harvest. It's called the first fruits. It is the absolute best. And you bring that to the temple of Jerusalem and you give that to God because you want to honor God. You want to thank God. And you also want God to bless the rest of your harvest so that it's bountiful and abundant and very good. So Jews from all over were coming to the temple at Jerusalem to celebrate this holy festival. They didn't all speak the same language. They didn't all have the same culture. But they all came to honor God. Now this happens... it occurs 7 weeks after Pentecost and begins on the fifth day, which is why in Greek this festival is called Pentecost. Penta, it means five. Occurs, well, not according to my research. Yeah. So that's why it's called Pentecost, because it's five, so Pentecost. But it's actually this Jewish festival. So out of all of the Jewish festivals, why did God choose this one? There's always a method to God's madness. God chose Pentecost because of the harvest. We harvest the first fruits. We harvest the best of the best, and we bring that to God. So then why did God have the Holy Spirit ignite the hearts of the disciples on Pentecost? Because God is harvesting that which God has watered and nourished and fed. Through Jesus Christ, God has been watering and nourishing and feeding us all the things that we need for this commission that God is about to give us. So now at Pentecost, God harvests us. God has given us everything we need to be able to go out and do what God is calling us to do. And that's why God chose Pentecost. And then all of a sudden the disciples start speaking in other languages. And all of those people who have come to the temple at Jerusalem to give God their first fruits can understand what they're saying. God takes away that barrier that stands between the people and the disciples. God takes away that barrier that stands between the disciples and their ability to do what God called them to do, which is to tell other people about Jesus. Tell other people what Jesus wants us to do. Notice that God didn't change the people and make them understand the disciples, make them learn the language of the disciples. God made the disciples able to speak all the different languages of the people. God made the disciples able to transcend culture, able to transcend language, so that they could meet the people where they were and preach the gospel to them. So Paul quotes Joel. And if you notice, In Joel, he talks about God pouring the Holy Spirit out on all people, not just the rich and the wealthy, not just the free, not just the men. Joel reminds the people all the way back in the Hebrew scriptures that God pours God's Spirit out on all people and gives the Great Commission to all people. Joel says, even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. So I said Paul, I meant Peter. Peter preaches to the people and says, women, slaves, all of those people who are on the margins, who we think can't possibly be used by God. Yeah, everyone is called by God. Everyone is gifted with the Holy Spirit. So now we're ready to go out, right? Are you excited? We're going to go out and tell everybody about Jesus. There might be some out there going, I don't think I know enough. I don't know how to do that. I'm uncomfortable. Oh. Jesus knows that. Jesus knows that. Because we get that in the Great Commission from John. Jesus says to the disciples, peace be with you. And if you notice, he says it twice. The first time, Jesus enters miraculously through a locked door because he's Jesus and he can do that. He enters miraculously through a locked door, and he says to the disciples, peace be with you. How we say that today is, don't freak out, because Jesus has just died on the cross. And so the disciples are seeing this guy that looks like Jesus, who just died on a cross, standing before them, talking to them. So Jesus says, hi, don't freak out. Yeah, this is really me. I really died on the cross. See, here are my wounds. It's real. And don't freak out, but I really did resurrect. So he's telling them, simmer, don't freak out. But then he says it a second time. Peace be with you. Don't freak out, but I'm going to send you just like God sent me. And that's exactly what we did. We all went, you're going to what? Like, I'll follow Jesus. I'll take your lead. You go ahead and do the preaching, and I'll just sit in the congregation and clap and say amen, amen, amen. Right? I can do that. I don't want to do the rest of it. And so Jesus goes, I know. Don't freak out. And then Jesus breathes the Holy Spirit on them. Just as God breathed in Genesis, life into the nostrils of Adam. So Jesus says, I got you. I got you. I'm going to give you all the power and authority that God gave me through the Holy Spirit. So I'm going to give you the Holy Spirit to strengthen you, to give you the skills you need, to guide you, so that you can go out and do what I need you to do. So it's the Holy Spirit when we're talking to friends and they're telling us they're having a difficult time and we get that thing in our body that says, oh, you should tell them about Jesus. And you're like, no. But that thing in you says, no, I'm not kidding. Do it. And it gives you the strength and the words that you need to be able to do that. Or it's the Holy Spirit that you start getting ants in your pants going, oh, I should do that. And you're thinking, I can't do that. I don't, no way, somebody else should do that. But it's that thing in you that you can't stop, that you have to do it, that you have to step out in faith thinking, yeah, I can do this. It's that fire that burns in your heart saying, hey, I need to do this. That's the Holy Spirit. So Jesus says, I'm going to send you out, but you're not going to go by yourself any more than I did. The Holy Spirit, God, me, are going to go with you and give you everything you need to be able to do this great commission that God gives after I go, which is the art, right? Jesus is no longer going to physically be with us. So we covered Jesus' face with this beautiful art piece because Jesus might no longer physically be with us. But Jesus is still with us through the Holy Spirit, still teaching, still preaching, still guiding, still doing all the things that Jesus did to water us, to nurture us, and to feed us so that God could harvest us during this Pentecost and then give us the Great Commission to go. St. Francis of Assisi says, when preach the gospel, and when in need, use words, which is a great saying. But the thing is, it's not very Lutheran, because we as Lutherans believe in both and. So we need to do both. Preach the gospel with words and preach the gospel with our actions. That's the Great Commission. That's what God calls us to do. But don't freak out, because we're not going to do it alone. God has given us the birth of a church. We have each other to go, oh my gosh, I think God's calling me to do this, and I really don't want to. And we can go, oh no, you can so do it. I'll help you. Or we can go, yeah, no, that might not be a good idea. The people here can help us discern the Holy Spirit and can help us to do the Great Commission. That's why Acts and Pentecost is the beginning of the church. It's the beginning of us going out into the world on fire for God, so that we can spread the gospel, spread our faith throughout the world, just like the disciples. So let's go. But don't freak out. God is with us. Amen. We are invited to be seated for the prayers.
Thank you.
united in the hope and joy of the resurrection, let us pray for the church, the world, and all in need. Passionate God, your passion for the world is inspirational. You love us so much that you promise to always be with us, and you never break your promises. Through the fire of the Holy Spirit, you share your passion with us. When we try and put that fire out because it forces us out of our comfort, our contentment, our rest, ignite it even more. Hear us, O Lord.
Your mercy is great.
Fire brings life and destruction throughout the world. We pray for areas affected by wildfires, burning temperatures, and heartbreaking drought. Renew the face of the earth. Hear us, O Lord.
Your mercy is great.
Your spirit embraces all. Send your spirit of understanding to immigrants, refugees, and those working at the borders. Keep everyone safe, fed, and nourished. Safely guide all who are fleeing war and danger. We especially pray for those on the screen and those we name now, aloud, and in our hearts. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Through your Holy Spirit, you give humanity a variety of gifts. Set aflame the desire to use those gifts to help bring about your vision for the world, to help those in need, and to make First Lutheran the church you want us to be. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
In your mercy, O God, respond to these prayers and renew us by your life-giving Spirit. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
We are invited to stand for the sharing of the peace, which is a sign of reconciliation and community. We share the sign of peace by waving or holding up the peace sign to one another. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you. See you. God's peace.
Our lives up to you, we are an offering.
Please join me in our prayer after offering. Holy God, gracious and merciful, you bring forth fruit from the earth and nourish your whole creation. Turn our hearts toward those who hunger in any way, that all may know your care, and prepare us now to feast on the bread of life. Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Evil, sin, and death tried to overcome God. The corruption and injustice of the world tried to win, but God is more powerful than corruption, injustice, and evil. Through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, God revealed God's power and God's never-ending love for us. And so we join in this song of praise. Are great and mighty. Strengthen us with the saving power you showed through the death and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ. May this sacrament of your body and blood work in us and show us how to live as your resurrection people. On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took the bread, blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, blessed it, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your love and teach us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Jesus Christ is the host of this meal, so all are welcome. It does not matter if you're a member of this church or if you're Lutheran by background, because at this table, all are welcome. So I invite those of you who are online to take your bread. The body of Christ, broken for you. I invite you to take your cup. The blood of Christ shed for you. May it strengthen and keep you now and always. Amen. For those of you who are in person, we have bread. I also have the gluten-free option available. Just let me know and I'll get that for you. We also have red wine, yellow grape juice, and water. So come, for the meal is prepared.
Yeah.
So that was so much fun. I was up here, and all the people said amen, started playing. And David kept going, amen. And then everybody who got communion, you know, usually it's thanks be to God, or they looked up at me with this big smile, and they go, amen. So it was wonderful. Please join me in our prayer after communion. Oh, God, we give you thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through the healing power of this gift of life. In your mercy, strengthen us through this gift in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another.
For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Now for our sending hymn, we're going to sing Spirit of the Living God. And I invite you all, when we get to the melt me, mold me, fill me, use me part, to raise your hands in the air asking the Spirit to fill you. So we are invited to stand and sing our sending hymn. Receive the blessing from God. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Amen. Now before we go, I'm going to pray over the food so y'all can get downstairs and get eaten. Holy God, we ask you to bless the food. May it strengthen us, nourish us, and feed us, so that we can go out into the world to preach your gospel and also use words. Amen.
Amen.
Go in peace. Share the good news. Thanks be to God.